What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. The subject of today's video is an algorithm that I personally find extremely fascinating because of its numerous applications. These applications range between airline scheduling, survey design, image segmentation, networking, and many more. So today we are going to explain and implement differently the Ford-Fulkerson algorithm. This algorithm is used for calculating the maximum possible flow in a graph. The term flow graph is used to describe a set of vertices and edges where one of these vertices is a source S and another a sink T. Each vertex except S and T can send and or receive stuff through them. S can only send and T can only receive stuff. As usual, to visualize this, let's take a water pipe network represented by the following graph. Each pipe or edge has a certain maximum capacity of water it can transfer at the same time. For this algorithm, we are going to find the maximum amount of water we can flow from the source to the sink at the same time, aka the max flow of the graph. Before I tell you what the actual algorithm does, let's try to intuitively find the max flow of this graph or water network. Take this path from S to T. The maximum flow we can throughput using it is 12 units. Now, take this second path here. The maximum amount of water that can flow is 4 units only. Notice how we always keep track of the units that are already flowing through the pipes, as while thinking, you should imagine water flowing in all directions through all the edges at the same time. Now, take a look at this path. 8 additional units can go through here, as the maximum we can still flow from S to B is 8. The last 2 units we can manage to squeeze are through this path, and after that we can say that our hands are pretty much tight and that the max flow of this graph is 26, as you can see. Now let's tackle the actual algorithm, and the process we are going to use and implement would be very similar to the intuitive one. The first thing we will do is fetch all of the possible paths we have on this new graph from S to T, or from the source to the sink. Next, we are going to sum the minimum flow of each path to obtain the max flow, all while subtracting this minimum from the path we are currently working with, so at some point this minimum will be 0. Don't worry, it is very similar to what we just did. Here, take a look. This path, for example, has a minimum flow of 12. So we subtract the 12 from all the edge weights belonging to this path and add 12 to the max flow variable. We do this with all the paths we found until we have no paths left. To note that there is a catch if you choose to apply this technique. You must traverse the paths by starting with the one having the highest minimum flow. Let me explain. So, here we have the possible paths you see. If we choose to apply this algorithm on the paths as they are currently displayed here, then the max flow we will obtain is 18. However, if we choose to traverse by starting with the paths having the highest minimum flow, in this case 12, and go all the way to the smaller flows, we will obtain the expected max flow of 26. Okay, let's go ahead now and try to implement this algorithm together. But before, I need to mention that the solution you will most probably find online uses a 2D matrix. However, in this video we're going for a different approach, even if the classic one might be slightly faster. So, the first thing we are going to do is create the vertex class which will represent the nodes of our graph. Just like the normal vertex class we previously implemented on several occasions, we will have a data attribute, a visited attribute, and a map representing the neighbors of this vertex. The keys of the map will be the actual neighbor vertices of that node, and the value is the weight or the flow capacity of the edge connecting the vertex with that neighbor. Now, let's go ahead and tackle the Ford-Fulkerson class alongside its run method. Similarly to what we discussed, the first thing we did was retrieve all the paths from S to T. And to store these paths, I created a private list of lists which will hold all the paths we fetch. And to fetch these paths, we are going to use recursion and make use of the helper method you see, which takes as first arguments the source, destination, and the starting path list containing at first only the source vertex. Before implementing this method, let's visualize it. Take this graph as an example. When we first pass in the source and destination, what this method will do is set the node we are at, the source in this case, to visit it. Then hop to its first neighbor and add it to the path. After doing that, we will do the same exact thing on its neighbors, hence the recursion. We will fetch the neighbors of that neighbor after setting it to visited and add the first one we encounter to the path. We will keep doing this until we reach the destination node, meaning the first path from S to T is complete. Then we will backtrack. So we will go back one or two nodes, depending on which last node in the path still has neighbors, and then hop again to the next neighbor. We will add this neighbor node to the path until we reach the destination and our path is complete. We will keep backtracking and adding nodes to every new path until all the possible paths are found. To implement this, as we mentioned, we will start by setting the source or the current vertex we are working with to visited. Then, for each unvisited neighbor of that vertex, we are going to add that neighbor vertex to the path at hand, which started off as the source. And then we will call recursively the same method on that neighbor, which will keep adding vertices to the current path variable, until a path is found. When a path is found, we add it to our list of paths and exit from the current execution. After we exit from the current recursive call, we go back to the parent call and backtrack to the next neighbor in line in order to find all the other paths. This is done by removing the current neighbor vertex from that path at hand. And finally, do not forget to set your current vertex to unvisited after you visit all of its neighbors to be able to revisit it from a different path in case it is traversed differently. Okay. Now that we have all the paths, what we need to do is, if you recall, before calculating the max flow, we need to sort these paths by highest minimum flow. And this was done with the help of the stream.sorted.reversed methods, as we need to sort in descending order. To get the minimum flow of a path, we used this helper method. What it does is simply retrieve the weights of the edges inside the path we are traversing, then fetch the minimum of these weights and return it. To do that, we are traversing the path, and for each vertex, we are retrieving its direct next neighbor used in this path from the map of neighbors. Note that the streams.range method has an exclusive end boundary, and that's great, because if we call this logic on the T or destination vertex, we will get an index out of bounds exception. Okay, after sorting our paths, what we need to do is traverse them in order, and for each one, fetch the minimum flow that can be traversed inside this path. This minimum should be subtracted from all the weights of the vertices appearing in this path and should be added to our max flow variable. Because we are using a map, to update the value of our keys stored inside it, we simply re-put the same vertex we had. However, this was done on a value subtracted by the minimum specific to the current path. And to update and return the max flow, we had to use the atomic integer class. You see, Java won't allow you to use the normal class in fear that you may be using parallel streams, hence accessing this variable by multiple threads at the same time. Let's go ahead now and test our code. To do so, I created several vertices and gave a weight to the edge separating them. The result should be similar to the graph we were working with at the beginning of the video. Then I called the run method of the class we just implemented, providing it with the source and the destination nodes, in this case S and T. And as you can see, the result is the expected max flow from S to T, the same exact one we deduced together. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.